Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, folks, wherever you guys are, whenever you're listening to this. My name is Prabhu Rambhadran. I'm a senior product marketing manager in the Windows Server and System Center product marketing team. I sit on the technical product management side, so I'm pretty hands-on with the technology. And my team owns the Windows Server and System Center suite of products. And today we are going to talk about what's new in the world of networking in Windows Server 2012 R2. And we'll also cover pieces in System Center and show how System Center 2012 R2 can help manage Windows Server 2012 R2, some of the core networking features that have been introduced in Windows Server 2012 R2. So let's move on. So over the course of this presentation, I'm going to talk about 4 to 5 different sections that I think would help you logically group technologies that we've introduced in Windows Server 2012 R2 in the world of networking. First, I'll spend majority of my time talking about software-defined networking. Every networking company these days, they've been talking about software-defined networking. It's huge, a lot of innovation having in this space, and Microsoft is spending a lot of time and is investing a lot in the world of software-defined networking. We'll then talk about how networking is helping deliver continuous application availability. So we'll talk about all the work that we've done to make sure that the applications that are running on the server are up and running all the time and are resilient to network failures that could potentially happen. Then we'll talk about how we are improving network performance. If you think about how the industry is moving towards, right, look at the high-level trends in the industry, we are seeing more and more customers using their existing network infrastructure for both storage, for internet traffic, for VM-to-VM traffic across multiple hosts, so it's all converging. So guaranteeing that high level of performance is becoming increasingly important. And the next thing that we are going to do is what we are doing in the management space to help network manageability. So all the investments that, again, we've done across System Center and Windows Server to help manageability. And finally, we'll close in with what we've done to seamlessly integrate the public cloud, which is Windows Azure, with either the service provider's cloud or customer's private cloud. So all the investments that we made in Windows Server that helps you seamlessly extend your data center beyond its own geographic location. So Windows Azure or a service provider is slowly becoming a logical extension to customer's own data center. So let's just dive in. So this slide basically talks about all the technologies that we've introduced in Windows Server 2012 and again enhanced with R2 across the pillars that I spoke about. There are a lot of features that are outside of what I've mentioned here. This is just a primer into what networking really has to offer with the R2 release. So we'll be talking about specifically these technologies over the next couple of hours. So before we get into any of the specific technologies in Windows Server 2012 R2 or System Center, let's just at a high level look at what problems customers are facing in terms of networking, right? So if you look into, you know, the compute space or the storage space, they've progressed a whole lot over the last 10 years. You have virtualization that almost every customer on this planet has gone through to kind of virtualize majority of their workloads. Storage virtualization is becoming more and more popular these days, with a lot of customers actually wanting, having a shared storage infrastructure and securely sharing it with multiple tenants. But networking, to a large extent, has been lagging behind. The concept of network virtualization is just shaping up, but networking, most people think of it as, you know, hardwired, physical, inflexible, and so on. And the other biggest challenge that exists in data centers today is that you have three silos that often don't work really well with each other, right? You have the server admins, you have the storage admins, and you have the network admins. So whenever you typically see a problem, the server admin tries to identify where the issue is. If it's not something that he or she cannot understand, it basically passes on to the network admin. The network admin takes their time, try to find out where the issue, and then more often than not, it comes back to the server admin, and then the server admin sends it back to the app world. So there's a lot of back and forth conversations, a lot of passing the buck that happens in terms of, you know, identifying issues. So these silos continue to exist today. They exist for a reason, which has helped enterprises in the past, but there are a lot of, you know, we need to get to breaking these shackles and, you know, having the server, the network, and the storage admins working together. Like I mentioned, you know, the physical network typically is not considered flexible. You have the NICs, you have cables that run into the NICs that really need to be pushed hard. The NICs could fail, the cables could be loose. Every time there is an issue, an actual person needs to go in there, remove the NIC, identify what's going on, check the cabling, and everything like that, right? And think of, you know, the graphic that I have here conveys the point that I'm trying to make. Think of just adding a single VM, right? Think of a multi-tenant environment where you have an app where you have several VMs that basically constitute a single app. If you just want to add a single VM onto a different host that's part of this specific app, look at the number of changes that you have to make, right? I'm basically adding the yellow VM now. So every time I add a new VM, I need to make a change at the host, I need to make a change at the top of rack switch, I need to make another change at the aggregation switch on both sides, right? On host A and host B, if that's those are the two hosts that are communicating with each other. So just to add a single VM, we are kind of looking at 10 different changes now. And a lot of these changes are manual and potentially error prone. And if you add to this that the network infrastructure underneath is kind of diverse. You have switches from Cisco, you have routers from Juniper, you have WAN app optimizers from Riverbed, for example. And each of these networking gear, it has their own management console. So in addition to managing your server, your virtual machine, your virtual switches, you're also managing different networking gear. So this basically becomes a hindrance in flexible networking, right? So this kind of drove the need for software-defined networking. So software-defined networking is, like I said, a transformation that the networking industry is going through. At a high level, no matter which vendor you're looking at, their solution falls under one of these three categories. The first one is around how we use software to enable integrated policies that span across both the physical hardware and the virtual layer. So you have the physical networks that I mentioned about the top of rack switches, the routers, and so on. And then you have the virtual network area where, you know, you have multiple VMs that all talk to a virtual switch, right? So as more and more workloads get virtualized, the virtual switch is slowly becoming more and more important. So what you're looking at is a single pane of glass or a single software that manages the virtual switch and the physical hardware underneath, using the power to manage these seamlessly. So that's one primary definition of software-defined networking. The other thing is around how we can abstract workloads from the underlying physical network. Think about server virtualization, right? What that lets you do is share the physical infrastructure across multiple VMs. But you cannot really do it with networking. The concept of network virtualization lets you define multiple network overlays so that these network overlays are flexible, are software defined, can be modified at any point with a single piece of software. So abstracting workloads with the from the physical network is another solution that's extremely popular. And the last thing is around how the data center traffic flow can be controlled at real time. Think about, you know, an application like Link or a network diagnostic tool that you write to diagnose networking issues. What you want to do is control the traffic across the entire network on the fly. In the Link example, Link might want to guarantee a specific quality of service, right? And Link wants to have the control of the underlying physical hardware so that it could reroute the traffic depending on what the best route or best traffic path is. And it controls this on the fly dynamically. And not every application needs it, but this is, again, another important solution in the software-defined networking space. So what does Microsoft have in this space, right? Let me just build a slide out for you. So we have a technology called Hyper-V Network Virtualization that we introduced in Windows Server 2012 that we've enhanced with the R2 release. We have Hyper-V Extensible Switch that again was introduced in 2012, enhanced with R2. We have complete management with System Center Virtual Machine Manager. And finally, we have an inbox gateway that connects the virtualized infrastructure world with the physical infrastructure world. So these are the solutions that we have, and I'll get into details over the next few minutes, but the mantra that we had when we designed these solutions were that all our solutions would be open, extensible, and standards-based. The protocol that we used for network virtualization, for example, is NVGRE. It's an industry standard protocol. It's not something that's completely proprietary to Microsoft. See, we work with the industry to develop that protocol. We wanted to make sure that our platform is open and extensible, where partners could develop solutions on top of us, and our solution and the partner solutions can work together seamlessly. We wanted to make sure that the SDN solution that we provide is built into Windows Server and System Center and is not a separate suite that customers will have to go and buy. If you look at VMware, with their recent announcements around NSX, which is an equivalent to Hyper-V network virtualization that we have, the biggest difference is that NSX is a standalone suite. So in addition to all the VMware investments that customers have, they also have to go and buy a network virtualization solution to virtualize the network. But we look at it at a pretty in a different way. We think customers should have the ability to have the flexibility and agility that modern data centers today have, be it with respect to virtualizing compute, virtualizing network, or virtualizing storage. All these solutions will be built into Windows Server 2012 and will be manageable with System Center. And the last thing, we want to make sure that we not only innovate at the software space, which is Windows Server and System Center, but we also work with our partners to innovate in the hardware space. And I have a list of partners that we are working with in the next few slides. So, you know, it's pretty important to understand the role of the Hyper-V switch as the industry goes through this transformation, right? Or in the world of software-defined networking. I briefly spoke about it a few minutes back. So as you have more and more workloads virtualized, your Hyper-V switch, which sits within your Windows Server or your hypervisor, is slowly becoming the real policy edge. So it's not the physical switch that lives behind the host, but it's actually the virtual switch that lives within the host. So this gives you the ability to define policies in the virtual switch and push it up to the VMs. And similarly, it lets you define policies in the virtual switch and push it down to the underlying physical switch. The other thing that it helps you do is that you have a single pane of glass or single software that manages both the physical switch and the virtual switch continuously. So like I mentioned, what's happening is that the Hyper-V switch is really becoming the policy edge in terms of networking. So that drives a need for this Hyper-V switch to be super rich in terms of functionalities and features that it offers. So in what we've done with 2012 is huge here, right? So we have technology that helps isolate traffic flow to guarantee a high level of security. Right, so I spoke about network virtualization that helps you isolate traffic flow. There is VLAN that's existed for a while. We have private VLANs where customers could define different VLAN mechanisms, promiscuous or community, depending on the level of isolation that they need. all that is built into the virtual switch now. We have the ability to shape the traffic. We have a lot of security features that's built in to the Hyper-V switch as well. Think about port ACLs, right? Ability to define ACLs to basically monitor the incoming or outgoing traffic, or block traffic based on IP address, incoming IP address, or outgoing IP address, or MAC address, for example. So just have the firewall capability defined at the virtual switch level so that you could consistently apply it across all the VMs that sit on top instead of applying policies at individual VMs. And that's extremely important for folks to understand. We also have tools, both PowerShell and, you know, something like Message Analyzer, to remotely capture packets, to do deep dives into, you know, the actual traffic that flows back and forth through the virtual switch. And finally, we have switch extensibility. The virtual switch that I spoke about in Windows Server 2012 or starting Windows Server 2012 is extensible. So I spoke about some of the features that we have within the virtual switch, right? We did not stop there. What we've essentially done is built an open and extensible platform so that partners could build extensions on top of the virtual switch, and these extensions can work seamlessly with other functionality that the virtual switch already has. So you don't have to rip and replace your virtual switch like how you do it with some of the other vendors, but instead you could have multiple switch extensions that work together at the same time, along with some of the functionality that the virtual switch offers. So this has basically fueled a lot of partners to develop functionality. For example, the Cisco N1KV, Cisco has an N1KV extension that's built in, that's built for the Hyper-V extensible switch. These extensions could either be packet forwarders, packet filters, or any of the other kinds, right? And Cisco N1KV is basically a packet forwarding extension that forwards all the packets onto the physical switch. So what you could do is enforce policy at the physical switch and the virtual switch using the N1KV solution, right? Again, like I mentioned, this works with existing virtual switch, and you could have multiple extensions all working together. There is a detailed SDK that's available for both customers and partners to help build more extensions. Like I said, there are capture extensions for basically capturing packets. There are filtering extensions where you could set or define rules to decide what kind of packets can go up, what kind of packets can come down, and there are forwarding extensions. So Hyper-V network virtualization. So at a high level, think of this as something very similar to server virtualization. Server virtualization let you use the same physical server and host multiple VMs on it, right? So you could have multiple tenants that sit on top of a physical server as VMs and get the isolation that it needs. And it also helps you manage your resources effectively, right? In the sense, if you need to spin up a new application, you don't have to spin up a new physical host. Instead, all that you do is spin up a VM on this host. So it lets you use your existing resources more effectively. And it gives you flexibility, isolation, everything that you need. And also use software to deploy VMs, to manage VMs, to push updates to VMs, and so on. So this kind of drove the whole flexibility in the data center, right? But like I said, network has been lagging behind. Network virtualization brings in this flexibility into the network world as well. So just the way you virtualize your physical server and have, let's say, a blue virtual machine and a yellow virtual machine, a Coke and a Pepsi, for example, you could also create these isolated networks depending on customer needs or depending on business needs and make them sit on a shared physical network. So that's essentially network virtualization, right? Use software to define virtual network overlays these network overlays don't reflect how the underlying hardware looks like or doesn't mimic a specific hardware vendor solution. Instead, it mimics the business need that customers have. And what you could effectively do here is basically, you know, create these VM networks on the fly, modify these VM networks, map VMs onto specific VM networks depending on the business needs, right? And still get the isolation that, you want. So like I mentioned, we use a protocol called NVGRE, which is Network Virtualization Generic Routing Encapsulation Protocol. So this basically helps with the isolation piece and the packet forwarding piece. So it basically helps you move your VMs from one piece of your data center onto another piece. And as long as they are within the same VM network, you can take your IP address when the VM moves. So if you, going back to the example that I had, if you have an app or if you have multiple VMs that constitute an app, if you move a single VM across, this VM has dependency with other VMs that exist, right? And if you change the IP address of the specific VM, the app essentially breaks. So with network virtualization, you have the ability to carry your IP address so that your app continues to work without any downtime at all. Getting into a little more details here. So what really happens underneath here, right? So in the specific example that I have two Hyper-V hosts, Hyper-V1 and Hyper-V2, right? And I have a customer, blue customer, the same example that we used before. And the blue customer has two VMs, a SQL server and a web front end. And the SQL server is hosted on Hyper-V1, and the web is hosted on Hyper-V2. In terms of IP address, right, you have something called the provider address, which is the IP address of the physical Hyper-V host. And you have something called the customer address. The customer address is my 10.1.1 address, which is what the customer brings in, right? So what happens is when packets from the specific VM, which is 10.1.1, go through the host onto the outside world, it actually gets encapsulated, and the IP address that goes out is that of the provider address, right? So the customer address is to a large extent hidden to the outside world. But how do we guarantee that isolation, right? So the SQL server 10.1.1 belong to a specific virtual network, which is my 10.1.1.0 virtual network, right? So all VMs of the blue network belongs to the specific VM network. Every VM network gets a unique subnet ID. So we use a combination of the subnet ID and the customer address to uniquely identify that specific VM. So for example, let me just build it out. So when 10.1.1 goes out to the outside world, or packets from 10.1.1 go to the outside world, it goes as 192.168.1.10, which is the provider address. Similarly, when packets from the yellow 10.1.1 go out, it's still the same 192.168.1.10. But the subnet ID of the blue network and the orange network is basically different. And that's how it uniquely identifies. And the host, the Hyper-V host, has the mapping between the VM, the subnet ID, and the physical host. It's centrally defined by System Center Virtual Machine Manager, pushed into the Hyper-V host, and the Hyper-V host kind of has a table that it uses runtime to map the packets correctly. So that's how network virtualization works underneath. The next obvious question is, okay, you do so much encapping, decapping of packets, right? And if as long as the packets are within my data center, it's all cool. But what happens when my packets leave leave my customer's data center or my data center? what are you doing to bridge the virtual networks with the physical networks or with, you know, packets that go into Azure, for example? That's where the need for an L2 gateway comes into the picture. The gateway basically maps the physical network with the virtual network. So all the packets that go to the external world typically goes through this gateway. The gateway does the NCAP decap. So it basically decaps all the extra information that NVGRE adds before it goes out. And then when a packet comes in from the external world, it basically encaps it again and then puts the information that the hosts need to route the packets correctly. In Windows Server 2012, we worked with a whole bunch of partners to build these gateway solutions. I have a list of partner solutions available, and I'll go over it over the next few slides. But with the R2 release, what we've essentially done is to have an inbox gateway. So Windows Server 2012 R2 can act as a highly available gateway to route the packets to the external physical world. So it's actually a VM, and the VMs could be clustered together, and each clustered VM set could handle over 100 tenants. So instead of having a single gateway machine for a single tenant, which really doesn't scale, what you are essentially doing is have a gateway for hundreds of tenants, for 100 tenants. And only if you need more tenants do you add another gateway. And the gateway is clustered and is active. What that means is that even when one VM dies, the other VM automatically takes over and starts forwarding the packets internally. So this helps, like I said, bridging physical network with the virtual network. It's available with Windows Server 2012 R2. There are pre-built service templates that are part of System Center Virtual Machine Manager that helps you deploy the R2 gateway. The other thing that we've done with Windows Server 2012 R2 is essentially with Windows Server 2012, if you have a switch extension, let's say a Cisco N1KV extension, excuse me, it doesn't understand NVGRE traffic. So switch extensions did not work with network virtualization. With R2, we've changed that. So the network virtualization filter driver is now part of the virtual switch. So this essentially means that you could have switch extensions working seamlessly on with network virtualization. So the same policies that you would enforce through a switch extension into into non-virtualized environments could now be applied into virtualized environments. So the other thing that I want to mention with the gateway is that in addition to packet forwarding, it also provides a site-to-site VPN and NAT functionality, network address translation. So the last piece that I want to talk about is around controlling data center flow. There is really nothing new in terms of R2 in controlling data center flow, but it's good for people to understand how this fits in. So if you haven't been noticing, so I'm basically, I went from abstracting workloads into controlling traffic using the virtual switch and switch extensions, and then I'm moving into how we can have integrated policies that span across the physical and the virtual network. So the controlling data center flow, like I mentioned, essentially gives software the power to control the data center traffic flow on the fly, right? For example, if the app determines that there is a better path to forward the packets along, it forwards that at real time. So that's basically the example that you're seeing here, right? And this is where protocols like OpenFlow or the Cisco 1PK solution comes in. An important nuance that customers have to understand here is that for you to make use of this functionality, you need to have specialized hardware gear and you need to make changes in your software to make use of the specialized hardware gear. A lot of vendors today have open flow controllers, open flow aware switches and routers, right? So what you need to do is get the specialized gear and then have software that could talk to the specialized gear. That's where, you know, the functionality is exposed from the networking gear through southbound APIs. There's a centralized open flow controller, for example, that talks to individual networking gear and then exposes a core set of functionalities for apps or for software to manage it. These core set of functionalities are called northbound APIs. And the software then calls into these northbound APIs to manage the underlying networking gear. So the challenges, like I said, are that, you know, it adds a little bit of complexity to the application. So you need to rewrite the application, or you need to modify the application to make use of this functionality. The other thing is that most customers have a heterogeneous environment, right? So like I said, if you need something like OpenFlow, you need devices that are OpenFlow aware. Most data centers are heterogeneous. They don't only have OpenFlow devices. They have traditional Cisco networking gear. They have networking gear from Juniper that may not be OpenFlow aware. So you need to guarantee that the hardware gear that you have is OpenFlow aware. So it creates a whole bunch of challenges. What are the typical use cases for something like this? First would be, you know, applications like Link or Xbox, where the app wants to guarantee a minimum level of QoS to the users, where it has policies where it needs a specific quality of service, and it monitors the network to identify which path gives that required quality of service. So specialized apps like Link or Xbox needs this functionality. Think about network diagnostic tools where, you know, you want to understand where a networking issue exists. So where you dynamically program the packets so that it goes through multiple paths depending on what it was asked to do. So it's not really applicable for all enterprise workloads at this point of time, but, you know, it's a great solution that customers like. The next thing that we've done in Windows Server 2012 R2 and to a large extent in System Center Virtual Machine Manager is this concept of OMI. So OMI is an open version of WMI, which has been there for a while. So this gives the ability to use PowerShell to manage OMI aware top of rack switches, for example, or OMI aware hardware devices. So in terms of, you know, support for OMI, Arista has announced that all their top of rack switches will support OMI. So this gives you the power to basically get policies from the top of rack switch from Windows Server, from your VM, from your application, set routing policies onto the switch. So it's kind of an extension of what I spoke in the previous slide. So this, again, takes SDN to another level where your software has complete control. So be it for information purposes, reporting purposes, or actually changing the way the packets get forwarded, OMI is huge. So like I said, you know, it helps you get and set policies and modify them real time. Using PowerShell, using System Center Virtual Machine Manager across a wide variety of top of rack switches across your entire data center. So we spoke about the functionality that's there in Windows Server 2012 R2 in terms of network virtualization, in terms of switch extensibility, right? Now let's get into the management space now. And System Center Virtual Machine Manager is kind of an SDN controller to a large extent. So it acts as a centralized fabric controller that helps you manage your virtual machine, your storage, and your networking layer. So I spoke about network overlays. So those network overlays could essentially be created from within System Center Virtual Machine Manager. So what you could do is create virtual networks based on what we call VM networks based on the business needs. For example, in the previous slide, I showed about showed the 10.1.1 customer address, right, customer application, and there are two VMs in it. So what you could essentially do with System Center Virtual Machine Manager is create those VM networks, create logical networks that sit below the VM networks. So think of, you know, a traditional data center. Like I mentioned, wide variety of switches and routers. The logical network abstracts that physical hardware and provides a unified set of devices or a unified plane for my VMs. Once I create these logical networks, the logical networks, again, think of it as how you want the virtual world to know how the physical world exists. In the sense, it kind of gives you a visibility into how the underlying physical world looks like onto the virtual level. So instead of dealing with the underlying physical layer directly, the VMs now deal with the logical network. And once you've created a single logical network that abstracts all the physical network, then you could create multiple VM networks on top of it, right? So VM networks could be per tenant, per customer in case of a hoster, and provides the isolation that you need. And all the VMs that are part of that VM network or that particular tenant belongs to that VM network. So Virtual Machine Manager essentially gives you the power to centrally define these VM networks, to create these VM networks, and apply it on to the host or multiple hosts. That's with respect to the VM networks, right? But there are other properties that are specific to the virtual switch. So if you look at, you know, the virtual switch and the properties that I spoke about there, you know, port ACLs, enabling SRIOV, for example, enabling, disabling it, enabling switch extensions, for example. So if you just have 10 hosts, then it's pretty easy for you to manage where you go into each of those hosts, use PowerShell, and then modify it to whatever value you want. But if you're managing at cloud scale, let's say that you have hundreds of hosts having thousands of VMs, you again want to have a level of abstraction where you define a set of policies or you define a template as to how your virtual switch needs to look like. So this logical template is called a logical switch. So think of the logical switch as to how you want your virtual switch across multiple hosts to look like. So you define the logical switch from within Virtual Machine Manager, and then you apply it across multiple hosts in your data center. So Virtual Machine Manager gives you that control, flexibility, and automation to apply it in an automated fashion across multiple hosts. And what it also lets you do is that once you've defined this logical switch, applied it onto a specific host, more often than not, server admins or network admins go and change a few things in the host directly. The logical switch also gives you the ability, or Virtual Machine Manager also gives you the ability to see if all the hosts within your data center are compliant with the logical switch that you essentially defined. So it's again a centralized place for you to define policies and apply it across your data center. So System Center Virtual Machine Manager also includes, like I said, ability to manage third-party extensions. Also, it has the ability to have OMI plugins for Arista, for example, so that you could enforce policies onto Arista top of rack switches from within System Center Virtual Machine Manager. This is new in R2. So I spoke about the partner ecosystem, right? So the gateway appliances, so these are the gateways that map the physical world with the virtual world. So we have F5, Iron Networks, and Huawei who have solutions for these gateway devices. These are physical devices. So if you have less than 100 tenants, for more often than not, the Windows-based gateway solution would be enough. But there are hosters, large-scale hosters, who want the performance and also the ability to manage hundreds of tenants, right? And that's a great case. That's one area when you would actually need a physical gateway solution. Like I mentioned, Arista has OMI top of rack switches. All the Arista top of rack switches are being certified for OMI. A wide variety of Hyper-V switch extensions. We have switch extension from Cisco for the N1KV solution. We have NEC. This is a pretty interesting switch extension. So NEC has the programmable flow, open flow controller, right? So the NEC switch extension is again a packet forwarding extension. So it essentially forwards all the packets onto the NEC programmable flow controller. So to a large extent, NEC has bridged Microsoft's virtual switch and their open flow controller to make the virtual switch itself behave like an open flow controller because it's managed centrally. It does the same thing. So that's a pretty interesting switch extension. And we also have chipset extensions from Broadcom, Intel, Mellanox, Emulex, and Brocade. Think of, you know, the ability to offload the encapping and decapping of packets, right? This helps improve performance significantly. Think of, you know, chunking the packet. So let's say that you have a 1 gig NIC and you're transferring large amount of data and you determine that, you know, the packets need to be split into smaller pieces before it gets sent. This takes CPU resources. With these chipset extensions that are pretty smart, NICs that come from Mellanox, for example, can do those chunking on its own without the whole CPU being involved at all. So it helps performance improve tremendously by almost 30% in some cases. So in terms of just summary around SDN, right, there are a few things that I think are worth pointing out. So what's the controller? So the parts in the left is probably what you hear from various networking vendors in the industry. And the parts in the right is what Microsoft has in this space. So our controller, like I mentioned, is System Center Virtual Machine Manager. So that's our SDN controller effectively. But it not only manages networking, it also manages storage and VM. So it's essentially our centralized fabric controller. It also manages load balancers. It manages gateway devices, and so on. Is our controller highly available? Yes, it's not active-active though, it's active-passive. So you could actually have two VMM servers, and if one VMM server goes down, another VMM server basically does the same thing. The reason this is important or people ask about it is because, let's say that I define policies in VMM, right? I define these VM networks, I define switch extensions. I push it across onto different hosts. Once the controller or VMM dies, the host does not get any more updates, obviously, right? The host continue to work with whatever updates it got from VMM the last time around. But most customers prefer this to be continuously available or highly available so that even if one node goes down, they could still make policy changes and add automation from another host. Fully functional layer 2 switch. Like I mentioned, we have Hyper-V extensible switch. Similarly, Hyper-V extensible switch and the NVGRE filter basically act as the logical router. We have both inbox and partner gateways for hybrid connectivity. For distributed firewalls, like I spoke about Hyper-V port ACLs, and I also spoke about filtering switch extensions. So both of them can act as distributed firewall. Both the physical network and the virtual network can basically work seamlessly because the conversion is done by the gateway. We have load balancing, the network load balance that's been with Windows, and we also have partner solutions from FY, Citrix, and Brocade that are NVGRE aware. We also expose an API platform for service providers to automate the whole thing. Like I said, Virtual Machine Manager does it, and we have Windows Azure Pack that uses REST APIs to basically automate the entire thing. We do physical network management, device management using OMI. We spoke about it. We have deep network monitoring. I'll get into it when I get into the management space. And finally, we have ASIC merchant silicon integration about the partners that we spoke about. So that's essentially what we are doing in the SDN space. So what we've essentially seen in this section is Microsoft software-defined networking solution. We saw all the functionality that's available in Box and the work that we've done with partners to bring software-defined networking to customers' data centers, right? In the next section, we would essentially see everything that we've done to improve performance, network performance, simplify network manageability, and how we could seamlessly connect on-premise data center with Windows Azure or service provider's data center. Thanks a lot for watching this video.